I might want to resuscitate Thomas Hobbes and have dinner with him.
I love how you assume that Thomas Hobbes would stick around you long enough to have dinner, let alone a full conversation like your Socrates or something. My friend, you are going to get one question at most like the rest of us, and to be honest, I rather hope you're not first in line so he's not put off too early.
The 17th century English philosopher who's mostly and I think unfairly associated with the idea that life in a state of nature is nasty, brutish, and short.
Why is that unfair? That's literally what he wrote, and he was right.
Hobbes was a witty and brilliant writer.
You should read him then.
He was a kind of psychologist who had a physiological, mechanistic view of thinking and emotion.
Thomas Hobbes had a mechanistic view of motion. That's amazing.
He put his finger on what might be the greatest violence reduction technique ever invented, that is a responsible government.
I'm sorry. Thomas Hobbes put his finger on responsible government. Are you serious? Chapter 18, Section 6 of Leviathan. Quote, because every subject is by this institution author of all the actions and judgments of the sovereign instituted, it follows that, whatsoever he doth, it can be no injury to any of his subjects, nor ought he to be by any of them accused of injustice, unquote. Responsible government, you think that's what he put his finger on? Good God.
And he, wherever you turn, I think, in psychology and philosophy, you find areas in which he had some bon mot or pensée.
You're a bon mot.
So I would love to pick his brains. I'd ask him how he would solve the problem of policing the police. He had this concept of a Leviathan, that is a government to which people would voluntarily surrender their autonomy in exchange for having him adjudicate disputes and basically keep us from each other's throats.
Everyone and their grandmother, and for clarification, despite his hair, Pinker does not fall into this latter category, thinks they understand Hobbes because of this erroneous cliché, and they don't. Thomas Hobbes isn't famous because he argued that you need a strong government because anarchy is dangerous. People knew that anarchy was dangerous before Homer. Aristotle wrote about this for God's sake. No, Thomas Hobbes is famous because he described the optical mechanism by which civil society maintains. And this is important because the Leviathan is not the government, but the person of the Commonwealth. Person here meant in the ancient Greek sense of the mask worn by a stage actor. A projection of the character into some visible sphere where it has otherwise no corporeal existence. Individuals also don't give up their freedom to deprive one another to the Leviathan, but to the Commonwealth, that is to say, to each other. The Leviathan exists to compel us to honor that mutual exchange of freedoms by fear. The Leviathan and the government are thus also quite different in Hobbes, because the persona of the Commonwealth has to be great and terrifying enough to hold all men in awe, whereas if you tell somebody that they're really just being administrated by a bunch of flabby old men at their desks, and that the local guard can be overcome like any other group of people, it will likely have, and has historically had, the opposite effect. So, if it's not the government, and it's not the Commonwealth, where does the Leviathan come from? This is one of the reasons why the first part of Hobbes' Leviathan, On Man, is so crucial to understanding the full relevance of the text. Hobbes characterized sense as the impression upon our bodies of external objects, and our imagination is just these impressions remaining after the object has ceased to press against us. Hobbes gives us the example of how, after staring at a strong light, we can often still see it after closing our eyes. Now, we sense many different things over the course of our lives, and this permits us, on this understanding, to form many different chimerical images in our imaginations by combining these different senses. So, for example, Hobbes suggests that because we encounter men and we encounter horses, and each leaves an impression upon our imagination, we can combine these two images to create the idea in our heads of a centaur. However, as this is a purely physical understanding of psychology, these impressions decay over time. Think of how a memory foam pillow slowly reverts to its original shape after you stop resting on it so that you can no longer see the contours of your skull. Similarly, over time, the original distinctiveness of our memories fade, and in the same way that a complex image looks simpler at a distance, when we think of the Commonwealth itself, what we imagine is not what it materially is. That is, a lot of tiny people administrating each other and doing a million tiny little tasks, none of which being particularly fearsome in themselves. But rather, we imagine the Commonwealth as one great body. It's like the difference between someone telling you that men are coming, and somebody telling you that an army is coming. Now, these can mean the same thing, but while you may imagine yourself, with a little luck, successfully fending off a plurality of men, you will likely not even think of attempting to single-handedly fend off an army. In fact, the difference in scale is such that no description of such an attempt would likely call it a fight. It would be an execution. The Leviathan is the person of the Commonwealth, imagined as one singular, gigantic entity. Despite the Commonwealth, in fact, being just a community of individuals as tiny and weak as yourself. And because of this tendency of us to imagine the state as this great monster, we find ourselves as confident that our neighbors won't attempt to unlawfully harm us, as we are that we ourselves would not dare try to take on the beast of the whole Commonwealth in armed combat.
But I'd say to him, well, you're kind of unclear as to whether this Leviathan would just be a fascist dictator.
He is unequivocally clear, and fascism wasn't a viable form of regime in Hobbes' time because we lacked the modern ideas of state, nation, etc., so the question is nonsensical historically. You seem to think that fascism means a guy tells me what to do. Buddy, that describes every political form.
As if that would be better than life in a state of anarchy.
It would, and Hobbes explains how we know. Chapter 20 of Leviathan, especially sections 2, 11, and 12, tell us how all covenants, including the social contract, proceed from fear, meaning that living in a society where you fear the local government does not nullify the contract unless they break it by violating your right to preserve your own life. Now, within a commonwealth, Hobbes insists that covenants made under fear of punishment are not really covenants. So, for example, blackmail is right out, and the Nazis weren't legitimate when they committed genocide against their own people. But the fact that a government is aggressive or illiberal is not by itself a reason for that government to be considered less preferable than the state of nature. In the state of nature, we find ourselves surrounded by innumerable potential little tyrants who have no covenant with us to protect our lives or our property. The image of the Leviathan also reminds us that should we leave society, there are larger animals than individual human beings lurking in the wilderness. Whether you choose to be a subject because your land was conquered and it was preferable to become a subject than to die, or you were born a subject and you remain so because it is preferable to obey the laws than to die, by Hobbes' logic, you have assented to the social contract as much as the imagined originators of the contract in a literal state of nature would have. In effect, you have declared your preference for that community than for the state of nature.
Well, one thing we've learned is not only is it better to have a government than to be in anarchy, but on the other hand, having a rapacious, aggressive government might be not much better than living in anarchy.
If you think that you're less naive than Thomas Hobbes, you are sorely mistaken, my friend. In fact, he talks at length about the ways in which a governing body can cause the dissolution of the Commonwealth through abuse. Now, if the Commonwealth chooses to prey upon you against the terms of the contract, that is by nullifying your ability to assent to its authority in exchange for your life, as what infamously happened in Nazi Germany, the contract is broken and you're in a state of nature once again.
I would ask him whether he could anticipate the concept of democracy.
I'm sorry, come again? You wonder if Thomas Hobbes could anticipate the concept of democracy? You know, Steve, democracy existed for thousands of years by the time Hobbes was writing. He talks explicitly about democracy in Leviathan, chapter 19, section 1. Quote, "The difference of commonwealths consisteth in the difference of the sovereign, or the person representative of all and every one of the multitude." And he goes on to say that if the representative is the assembly of all that will come together, then it is a democracy. When you researched for this talk, did you just read the back blurb on the Penguin edition? Have you ever read more than that? I know first-year undergraduates who have a more sophisticated understanding of Thomas Hobbes than you. Just, man, where did they dig you up?
And how his own view of human nature could be confronted with the idea that whoever is leading the government would himself have the flaws of human nature.
Chapter 22, section 7, quote, "In a body politic, if the representative be one man, whatsoever he does in the person of the body, which is not warranted in his letters nor by the laws, is his own act, and not the act of the body nor of any other member thereof besides himself. Because further than his letters or the law's limit, he representeth no man's person but his own. But what he does according to these is the act of everyone. For the act of the sovereign, everyone is author, because he is their representative unlimited. And the act of him that recedes not from the letters of the sovereign is the act of the sovereign, and therefore every member of the body is author of it." Unquote. Here we see a clear separation between the sovereignty in itself and the individual human being who holds its office. The fact that such an individual would carry with them all the weaknesses of being human is trivial, and in fact Hobbes does go into some depth concerning how his advisors and other supports should be arranged so that he errs as little as possible, and by some depth I mean tens and tens of pages. The entire premise of political philosophy since, well, prior to Aristotle, has been that the primary reason human beings enter into communities is that they are weaker and more vulnerable and all around capable of less outside of them. Had you asked this question of Hobbes to his face, as you comically said here that you wish you could do, he would laugh in yours.
How do you square that circle?
Knowledge is good. This video was a scandal, and this wig-wearing wig should be wigging out in embarrassment for it, but that doesn't mean that you should. Read this. Take care.